Murphy, some of us walk in here not because we are all healthy, bouncy, up and going, but because we feel God wanted us to be here this time. So we want to pray for Minister Diane Kennedy, who drove all the way from Uwetown, you know. She knows what's going on in her body also, but we want to pray for her. And we want to pray for Justin Cunningham. His grandmother passed. Yeah, yesterday they had a homegoing. I would say it was a beautiful homegoing. Beautiful homegoing, nevertheless, you know, that's family situation. So, but we want to pray for everybody. I mean, I name all, but you are sitting in here this morning. You are connected with somebody you know who's in the hospital. Brother Fred Buckins, one of my missionaries, all the way to the jungle of Africa, and his wife Celia. Pray for God to just strengthen them. Pray for Coretta and her family also, for the bereavement. Pray for Melinda. We just want to lift everybody up. So let us pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we stop to say, Lord, we recognize your presence, that without you, we are nothing. But with you, God, we are everything. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for loving us. Thank you, God, for choosing us individually. Thank you for calling us by name. Thank you, God, for your manifold provisions, for your protection on our lives. Thank you for our children. Thank you for our loved ones. Thank you for our parents, for our family. Thank you for our church. God, thank you for the job you provided for us. Thank you for transportation. Thank you for food, for clothing, for shelter. Thank you for job, God. We love you. Hey, thank you for giving us a gift of yourself, for Jesus. Lord, as we come to worship today, Lord, you read our heart, as you already know. Touch us according to our needs. We say, Lord, you be. Let your grace be all over this place, and knowing this room, knowing the singing, knowing the preaching, oh God, and knowing the giving, and knowing the prayer, and knowing the fellowship, the handshake. We pray, Jesus, that you will bless someone today. Even as we minister, if someone does not know Jesus, Holy Spirit, please touch their life. Help them to find salvation. For it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Let the church say amen. Amen. If you believe in Jesus, say amen again. If you believe that Jesus is alive, say hallelujah. And the praise team will come to just lead us in a time of singing, praising, shameless praise. Just celebrate Jesus.
Amen, amen, amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We're here to magnify Jesus, to lift him up, to glorify his holy name. To that we give thanks. As many as can, let's stand to our feet and worship our God. Amen. Oh, give thanks for him, the Lord, for he is good. Yes, he is good. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Yes, he is good. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Yes, he is good. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Yes, he is good. For he is worthy.
Unto the Lord, for he is good. Hallelujah. The word of God tells us that God is good, and he is good what?
All the time.
Amen. I love the way David said in the book of Psalms that God is good and he is always doing, looking out for our best. Amen. Hallelujah. For Jesus.
Herald by the angels born.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord, we just bless you and honor you this morning. You said if you be lifted up, that you will draw all men unto you, Lord God. We sing our praises to you, Lord God. God, we thank you how you fill us with your spirit. And Lord God, you say you have poured your love inside of us. So at this moment, amen, can we just do something? Can we just walk around for a minute, shake a hand, hug a neck? Let's just, amen, just invite. Let's just love on somebody just for a little while. This is our time of our love feast. Hallelujah. God bless you. God bless you. Come on, let's just love on each other for a few moments. Amen. Then we'll get back into this thing called praise and worship. Hallelujah. God loves for us to minister and sing about his wonderful name. I want to welcome our global faith family and bless God for you. For those that are unable to make it, we are praying for your strength in the Lord. And we want to also encourage those that are able to make it out to the house of God. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord Jesus. Come on, let's just spread that love. Spread that agape, amen, the unconditional love, that true love. Yes. We bless you, Lord God. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah. As that praise team is making that way on back up. Amen, amen. Hallelujah. We're going to continue to praise God. Amen. Yeah, Lord. That's it. Love on each other. That's what it's all about. Amen. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples. It's that you have love one for another. Hallelujah. Yeah. Come on, Derek.
Listen.
That's it. Come on, give the Lord a hand of praise. The Bible calls us trees of righteousness. Amen. Amen. The trees shall lift their hands. Amen. They shall clap their hands. And we honor our God in this place. As we continue, amen, just in our time of worship, praise God. We have, praise God, amen, Brother Andre is going to come and minister to us. Hallelujah, Jesus.
I give myself away.
Is in your house.
Let's give Jesus some praise. I know we just sing, I give myself away. I give myself away. I give myself away. Singing is good. Some of us can't sing. So maybe you want to say that again. I give myself away. Amen. Before our scripture reading, which Victoria will do, I just wanted to let us all share with you again, BRCC. Because we are a faith family, you know, Jesus said, when you fast, don't let anybody know. Go ahead, get dressed like me, put your lotion on, cut your hair, keep a smile before people pity you. Amen. Yes. Because if you want to get people's attention, then that's your reward. But there comes a time when you do community fast. A community, that's our church like this. So BRCC, December 23rd, begins our fast, which we're going to undertake for the next 2 weeks. We will break that fast on the 17th of December when we have our friend and family day. We are asking all, appealing to all, everybody who named the name of BRCC. And actually those who fellowship with us as believers in Christ, those listening to this broadcast, we are asking you to please join hands, join our faith, to wait before the Lord on behalf of our church. Well, you might say, you know what? I don't think I'm ready to fast because pastor said we should fast, and then you're right. What I want you to do is, say, even though pastor asked me to fast, but I'm going to do it because he said the Lord said I should do it. Amen? Do it for Jesus. Do it for God. Wait on God and see what God will do. So we went ahead and printed some information. What's Karen? Printed some information. Karen Lacey has. Some of you have already received some. We started on Friday when we prayed. It'll kind of break down to you how the process, the fasting process goes. And fasting is not necessarily not eating your hamburger and fries. It's about being intentional on listening to God, waiting on God, you know, reading your Bible, meditating. And maybe in these days and times, abstain from those things that distracts you the most. So one of those things I have chosen is to not be doing texting all week long, but to wait on God. For some people, it might be to just shut that cell phone off. The TV, Auburn, Alabama game, or maybe that meatloaf. But whatever that feels pressing to you, that you can say, God, I want to try giving this up so that you can speak to me to get my attention, like God got Moses' attention through the burning bush. Do that. Our church needs prayer. We can do all the preaching, all the teaching, all the singing, but we need to pray because prayer is where our power lies. So I want to encourage all, beginning Monday, 6 to 6:30 a.m., we will be on Zoom. Our regular Bible study Zoom, please join. It's 30 minutes. Some people got to go to work, take kids to school. We are there to pray. And then in the evening, the ministers who have small groups, the shepherds, they will organize, and you have community meeting time, however they choose. I think there is this stuff on Microsoft. How do you call it? Miss Allison, what's that stuff we use for meeting? Google Meet. Everybody can meet the same time. Zoom, we can't do. Google Meet is okay. So your shepherds will get in touch with you, and you will meet in the evening for 30 minutes to pray. In the morning, I will be presiding over Zoom, and we will meet for 30 minutes. If you have time to join us, join us. If your work demands you not to be there, please don't feel guilty. We will be covering you in prayer. Amen? So we start our fast when today, right? Today we end on Sunday, December 17th, when we come for our fellowship to break bread together. There will be a lot of food in the house. So, and then after that, we can go on in. Then, you know, we will ask the Lord to show us when the next fast will be. We want to spend much time in prayer, folks. We need to be delivered. We need to be healed. We need to be directed. Families need strong foundation. Only Jesus can do that for us. The money can't do it. You can have all the money, have the best house, do all you can, you know, cars and all that. Listen up. When it comes to the nitty-gritty, when your life needs to be held together, it's Jesus Christ. So we will be fasting and praying. Victoria, come on to read the scripture. Let's give God some praise for this lady who's come early this morning to just share the word of God with us. Amen. And after that, I know our own minister, teacher Traci Stone, will break the bread of life today. Amen. Come on.
Good morning, BRCC. Let us all stand together for the reading of God's word. Today's reading will come from 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verses 1 through 5. I will read a verse, you'll read the one that follows, and we'll read the last one together. And the NIV reads, "And now, brothers and sisters, we want you to know about the grace that God has given the Macedonian churches.
Their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity.
For I testify that they gave as much as they were able, and even beyond their ability." I'm sorry. "In the midst of a very severe trial." No, you did just read that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, so go ahead.
Three.
"For I testify that they gave as much as they were able, and even beyond their ability, entirely on their own.
They urgently pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing in this service to the Lord's people."
And together.
"And they exceeded our expectations. They gave themselves first of all to the Lord, and then by the will of God also to us."
This is the word of the Lord.
Come on, church, let's receive the preacher with a hand of clap. Amen and amen and amen.
Amen. Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Sister Victoria, for reading the scripture on this morning, and many thanks to our praise and worship team. We are continuing, as most of you guys know, Children's Church is open, and so our little people can be dismissed, except that they don't want to be. Amen. We are continuing in the book of 2 Corinthians, and as Pastor said, we hope to wrap up 2 Corinthians by December, or by the end of December, and start a new book at the beginning of the year. And so today we are going to continue with 2 Corinthians, the 8th chapter, and we are going to go 8 and 9 today because they are very similar in nature. And so for those of you that are like, "Oh, here's Sister Traci again talking about giving." Well, don't get mad at me. It's in the book, right? And we have to study God's word based on what God's word declares. And so I asked Sister Victoria to read 2 Corinthians, the 8th chapter, only verses 1 through 5, because I want those verses to actually set the stage for the rest of Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 8 through 9. So in 2 Corinthians, the 8th chapter, verses 1 through 5, Paul starts off talking about the Macedonian church. And if you will, I'm going to actually read it out of the Good News Translation version. And it reads, "Our friends, we want you to know what God's grace has accomplished in the churches in Macedonia. They have been severely tested by the troubles they went through. But their joy was so great that they were extremely generous in their giving, even though they are very poor. I can assure you that they gave as much as they could, and even more than they could, of their own free will. They begged us and pleaded for the privilege of having a part in helping God's people in Judea. It was more than we could have hoped for. First, they gave themselves to the Lord, and then, by God's will, they gave themselves to us as well." And so when we look at 2 Corinthians, the 8th chapter, when we take that little snippet of scripture that Paul is sort of setting the stage for giving, I want you to understand that 2 Corinthians chapter 8 sort of lays out the aptitude for giving, and then 2 Corinthians chapter 9 lays out the attitude for giving. So Paul sets this stage and in a manner of he's saying, this is what you give, and then this is how you give. And so in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, we're going to look at the what, and then in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, we're going to look at the how. Amen? Y'all still with me? Pastor, we may have had it too warm in here. All right. So 2 Corinthians chapter 8, Paul starts out by saying, I want you to know about the Macedonian church. Now, this is an interesting church because it's located in northern Greece, whereas the Corinthian church is located in southern Greece. The reason the Macedonian church is interesting is because there was, and you guys have probably heard of him in history, Alexander the Great, right? He was history tells us he was one of the greatest conquerors. He went through and united all of these kingdoms. Well, one of the kingdoms he united was Macedonia. Previously to his father and him, they had been scattered tribes. And so under Alexander the Great, they came together and became a united nation. Well, Alexander the Great was going through doing conquest after conquest after conquest. And then somewhere along the way, he came to a banquet. And history doesn't agree as to what happened during the banquet. All they really know is between 8 to 14 days later, he died. Now, whether it was of poisoning or sabotage, it's not really clear. But what is clear is that he died, and he died in agony. After Alexander the Great passed on, that kingdom that was once united became fractured. And no one after him was able to pull the kingdom of Macedonia together again. And so the Romans came in and they decimated Macedonia. And so the citizens of Macedonia were left in pretty much poverty. They didn't have much of anything. And so the church was comprised of believers that didn't have much of anything. And so they were very poor. And so Paul contrasts the Macedonian church, who was very poor, to the Corinthian church, who in their eyes were very rich. And Paul is saying, let me tell you about the Macedonian church. This group of believers to the north of you that are sort of poor, well, they're working in a thing called God's grace. And because of God's grace, God is enabling them to do more abundantly than what they ever thought was possible. And so to our BRCC family, I want to remind you that God's grace enables you to do more than you ever thought was possible. It's because of God's grace that enables you to go above and beyond anything that you can ask for, anything that you can think, anything that you can imagine. If you put if God puts his grace on your natural ability, then he enables you to soar far above what you ever thought was possible. And so for the Macedonian church, Paul said they gave what they could, but even above and beyond what they thought they could give, they gave. And it's only because of God's grace. And so the first thing that I want you to understand when we talk about the what to give is that there is a grace for giving. And there is a grace that enables you to give more than you ever thought was possible. But in order to access that grace, you have to, as Paul said, give yourself first to God. So Paul said the Macedonian church, they first gave themselves to God. And so you give yourself first to God, and then you ask God to come in with your giving. Because a lot of us, and I'm guilty of it, we write a check, or we do a Cash App, or we do a Venmo, or we just have our tithes come out of our regular account. We want to give something, it just comes out of the account. We never really say, okay, God, what is it that you want us to give? We never really say, Lord, I don't have much, but what I have, you can have, and I'll give it to you. But the Macedonian church, even though they were poor, they were like, okay, God, what is it? And Paul says they were so poor, I didn't even want to ask them to give. He said, but they begged and they pleaded with me to be able to give. And so there is a grace to giving. You have to give yourself first to God. But then as we work our way through 2 Corinthians chapter 8, I want you to understand that you can't give what you don't have. Your giving is not predicated on somebody else. You give what God has placed on your heart to give. Like, you can't say, well, Sister Traci gave $100,000. And before some rumor get started, I didn't do that. But hey, if God gives it to me, I won't hesitate. you can't say Sister Traci gave $100,000 and so I'm going to try to match what she gave. And y'all know by now, if I'm a dream, I'm a dream big. So why stop at $100,000? I might as well give $1 million if I'm going to give $100,000, right? But what you can do is say, Sister Traci, Sister Jenny, BRCC is giving their best, so I'm going to give my best. Your giving, you can't give what you have, but you also have to realize that your giving or the acceptance of your giving is not based on an amount. You get me? Like, it's not whether you give $1 million or $1. The amount is not what's important. What's important is your heart when you're doing the giving. What's important is that you have come before God, you've laid it out before Him, and whatever you've decided in your heart to give is what you are going to give. And some of you may say, but wait a minute now. Aren't all givings acceptable? Like, if I give anything, isn't that a good thing? And so I'm going to ask you to turn with me to Acts, the fifth chapter. And as we're looking at Acts, the fifth chapter, we're going to go through verses 1-5 real quick. And you guys know the story. It says, but there was a man, reading out of the Good News, there was a man named Ananias who with his wife Sapphira sold some property that belonged to them. But with his wife's agreement, he kept part of the money for himself and turned the rest over to the apostles. Peter said to him, Ananias, why did you let Satan take control of you and make you lie to the Holy Spirit by keeping part of the money you received for the property? And listen to this, because this is pretty interesting. He said, before you sold the property, it belonged to you, right? So Paul is like, it was yours. Before you sold it was yours. And then after you sold it, the money was yours, right? So he's not saying everything you have belongs to the church. God is not saying everything that you have to give to the church. As a matter of fact, Peter said before you sold it was yours, and after you sold it was yours. He said, well, but why then did you decide to do such a thing? You have not lied to people, you have lied to God. And as soon as Ananias heard this, he fell down dead, and all who heard about it were terrified. Now, I got to tell y'all, I may have been like, ooh, I don't know if I'm giving anything because they be killing people that give over there. But the whole point was it wasn't the amount he gave. It wasn't the fact that he only gave part of it. It was the fact that he lied about it. And sometimes when we compete with each other, we're lying to ourselves. And we're lying to God's Holy Spirit. Because we're competing or we're trying to outdo each other instead of trying to lay or do what God has placed on our own hearts to do. And so Paul says that you can't give what you don't have, and true giving is not based on an amount. Rather, it is based on the condition of your heart. And then as we continue to work through 2 Corinthians chapter 8, Paul tells the Corinthian church, finish what you've started. He told the Corinthian church, and this is sort of, you know, we decided early on their pride was what got them in trouble. They were proud of their faith. They were proud of their ability to speak in tongues. They were proud of their ability to learn the scripture. And Paul says, if you guys are so proud of everything you've done, I need you to not just be proud of your faith, but I need you to excel in your giving also. And so for some of us, we take pleasure in our faith. We take pleasure in our ability to pray. We take pleasure in our ability to fast. We take pleasure in our ability to study the scripture. And yet when God places it on our heart to give, it becomes my money and not God's money. Or it becomes my so-and-so and not God's so-and-so, my house and not God's house, my this and not God's this. And ultimately, what we have to understand is everything we have, it belongs to God. He gives it, and he can take it away if he so desires. And so it's not for us to sit there when God is prompting us to give. It's not for us to sit there and say, but God, this is mine. Because ultimately he says, yeah, but it belonged to me first. And I loaned it to you. And I had to learn that the hard way. And y'all know what? It wasn't with money that I had to learn that with. It was actually with my kids. And you guys have heard me say this before. My kids were going on a mission trip. And my babies was going a long, long way. They was going to like Costa Rica and Belize and, you know, all of these places. And I couldn't go. And I'm like, but Lord, they're my babies. You want me to send them where? And I'm like, but what if something happened? And he like, but I can take care of them over there the same way I can take care of them here. And I'm like, but I'm not there to protect them over there. And he's like, but you're not protecting them here either. And I'm like, but, and he was like, they belong to me before they belong to you. Right? And I'm like, oh, okay, Lord, but I'm just going to have to not eat anything until they get back, you know, because I believe you, but I'm going to do everything, you know. So we want to hold on to stuff that we believe belongs to us. When God is saying a closed fist doesn't get fed, sometimes you have to let those arms, those hands be wide open for him. Think about it. When he died on the cross, his hands were wide open. Which leads me to my next thing. Paul tells the Corinthian church, and really if you want to compare yourself to something or someone, the greatest gift that was given was the gift of Jesus Christ, who died and gave his life for your sins, our sins, for eternity, or for all people. And so Paul tells the Corinthian church in verse 8 that you've got to release what God has given to you, but I want you to be prepared. So I'm sending Titus to you. And when Titus gets there, I want you to be ready. And that way we won't be ashamed. We are working our way down through 2 Corinthians. And so in 2 Corinthians 10 is where Paul says, again in the Good News Translation, my opinion is that it is better for you to finish now what you began last year. And so we understand that this campaign that the Corinthians started actually started a year ago. And so this wasn't anything new to them. But what we have to understand was that a lot transpired in that year. During that year, there was friction between the Corinthians and Paul. Paul had to write what he considered a stern letter. And so Paul was like, let me send Titus to pick up that money, because if I go, they may not be, they might be a little bit upset with me. They may not want to let it go. But I'm going to send Titus, because Titus has a heart for the people of Corinth also. And so he sent Titus to pick up that money. Now, one thing Paul told the Corinthian church is, it's not a commandment. I'm not commanding you to give. Because if you command somebody to give, then in the old church, that was considered taxation. Like, we have to pay our taxes, right? When we give, we are to freely give. We are to give from a generous heart. We are to give not because we are commanded, not because we are obligated, but because we desire to give back to God that only a portion of that which he has given us. And so our giving is to be freely done. Let's go to chapter 9, 2 Corinthians chapter 9. So remember, chapter 8 tells the what to give. Chapter 9 tells the how to give, or the attitude to give. So in chapter 8, we've established the what, which means that you can't give what you don't have. You give what's laid on your heart to give. You give what you and God, what you've prayed over and what God has determined that you give, whether it's $5, $500, $5,000, $500,000, $5 million. And if any of you guys are able to give $5 million, God bless you. But the amount is not as important as your heart. So even though you're able to give $5 million, it does not mean that you're more blessed than somebody that's able to give $5. Because a lot of times money comes in and it messes up things. And so what Paul wanted them to understand is that sometimes the people that are in poverty are more happier or more content than the rich man. Think about the rich man and Lazarus. Remember? The rich man had everything that he could have while he was here on earth. And Lazarus stood at the gates begging for scraps. And then when they passed on, the rich man was tormented and Lazarus was in Abraham's bosom, is what scripture tells us. And so just because you have money does not mean that you are content with money. We'll just leave it right there. All right. So let's go on to 2 Corinthians chapter 9. And Paul says, there really is no need for me to write to you about being sent to God's people in Judea. And y'all know what? Y'all getting quiet in this Presbyterian church on this morning. Is it because we talking about giving or what? That's all right. That's all right. It's tight in this camp, but that's okay. That's okay. It might be tight, but it's right, and it's in the Bible, and that's what matters, right? Okay, amen. All right, so 2 Corinthians chapter 9. Paul says, there really is no need for me to write to you about the help being sent to God's people in Judea. I know that you're willing to help, and I have boasted of you to the people in Macedonia. And so he's still dealing with the Corinthian church versus the Macedonian church. And Paul is saying, when I went to Macedonia, I boasted about you guys. I told them how willing you were to help. I told them how excited you were to help. And because of you guys, how excited you were, that made them excited to help also. And so then Paul reminds them, the church in Corinth, that I'm sending a brother to help you. And I looked this up, and throughout the ages, people have tried to figure out who was this brother that Paul was sending to the Corinthian church to carry the donation back to Jerusalem or back to Judea. And nowhere in the scriptures can they find the name of this person. And I'm like, well, that's probably smart, because if all the churches know that Brother John or Sister Susie is about to take a large collection back to Jerusalem, Brother John or Sister Susie probably ain't gonna make it. Like, now think about it. Y'all know how we are. Hey, I'm not supposed to tell you, but I heard from such and such and such and such that Brother John was tasked with taking the money back to Jerusalem. And girl, you know it was a big pot of money. Don't tell nobody I told you. And then what they do? They go to the next. Hey, I heard that sister said, but I'm not supposed to tell you, but you my friend. I know you would never tell anybody else. So I'm going to tell you. And then poor Brother John got bopped upside the head somewhere on the road because everybody know that he's taking the money back. So Paul never mentions who this guy is or who the brother is that is going to take the offering back, but he does say that he is well spoken of. And Paul does say that we are accountable. And so while we've been talking about how to give, in this, Paul also gives a little snippet about how we are to receive. As a church, we are accountable for the things that people give us. We cannot afford to splurge or misuse money that comes into us. Paul says that we have to give an account of that. We have to make sure that we are being good, that we are being responsible, that we are being not considerate, but that we are overseeing, being good overseers of what God has given us. And so as we continue on in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, one thing that we learn is that right giving is always blessed. Think about that. Right giving is always blessed. When you give from a right motive, when you give from a right heart, when you give from a right point of view, that is always blessed. Now, it does not mean that you will get money for money. But when you give right, you can be blessed in different ways. So spiritually, you can be blessed. Mentally, you can be blessed. Emotionally, you can be blessed. And then financially, you can be blessed. I think God planned it this way. And so, Katie, I'm sorry, but you were already in my notes. So God set you up. But most of you guys, or if you guys don't know Caitlin, Caitlin has a ministry, Considerate Care. And what she does is she gathers things throughout the year, and then at the end of the year, she goes and she delivers care packages to the homeless. I don't know how many people outside of BRCC knows she does this. But I had the best time one year when we went and we were helping them prepare food and we were helping them give things out. I received a blessing from being able to do that. I believe that God has blessed Caitlin's life because she has done that. But he's blessing her in different ways. It's not just the money that she's getting back. But God can bless you in totally different ways when you give with the right motive. And so he blesses us in various ways. And so we don't give so that we can get. Do y'all understand that? We don't give money so we get money. We don't give. Now we do put God on his word. Because Malachi says, prove me in this and see if I will not open up the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing such that you will not have room to receive. So we do remind God of his word. But it does not mean that we say, oh, I'm going to give $100 because I need $1,000. We don't give to get. But we do understand that we get things. And that God, we get things to us that we give out. So if God can get it to us, he should be able to get it through us. And the thing, the example that I like and the example that I've always thought about is you can't send water through a pipe without the pipe getting wet. Somebody's going to catch that. Listen to me. If you are a pipe, if you are a conduit, God cannot send water through you without you getting wet. Meaning God will not send money to you or through you or blessings to you or through you without blessing you in the process. We are called to be channels of blessing and not reservoirs of blessings. The blessings are supposed to flow through us, not stop at us. We have been placed in this community for a reason. The blessings are supposed to flow through BRCC and not stop at BRCC. When people give to BRCC, they should be able to understand that they are not just giving to four walls within a building, but that their giving will make an impact in the community. Not just 35235, not just 35215, not just 205, 256, or 334, but a global faith family should be touched because someone gave to BRCC. But it starts with your heart. And it starts with you giving to God first yourself. This one I like. And I've always, God has always reminded me of this, but one of the things that he told me early on, and I'm just going to tell you, remind this to you guys, is that if I could paraphrase Paul a little bit in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, is that you can never give more than God can restore. Everything belongs to him. You can never give more that he can restore to you. You can never give more love than he can give back. You can never give more time because he's a redeemer of the time. You can never give more money because the cattle of 1,000 hills belongs to him. There is nothing you can give more than that he cannot restore. Everything you give out, he can restore back to you. And I don't understand why sometimes in the church we think that my loving Sister Diane means that I don't love Sister Gertrude. Right? When we love each other, God is so great that he can love all of us individually and collectively. I am a reflection of his love. So why can't I love Mama Diane and Mama Gertrude the same way? Why can't I love Brother Nehemiah and Brother Sam also? Why is it that we have to pick and choose who we love and who we give to? We can never give more than God can restore. There's a theologian named Clark who wrote this. He said, Jesus Christ, the gift of God's love to mankind, is an unspeakable blessing. No man can conceive, much less declare, how great this gift is. For these things the angels desire to look into. Therefore, he may be well called the unspeakable gift, as he is the highest God ever gave or can give to man. So no matter what you give, you can never give more than what God has given to you. God has given you his son. God has given you life. God has given you hope. He's given you dreams. He's given you visions. He's giving you the ability to pursue and overcome. And sometimes we still want to hold on tight to that which we have instead of releasing it out. And I think sometimes the reason we want to hold on tight is because we're afraid that if we let it go, it'll just flutter away. And Paul told the Corinthian church, you're not giving so someone else can be lazy. When Caitlin gives, she's not saying, oh, I can't give to them because they're too lazy to get up and go do it for themselves. She's saying, you know what, God, you put a desire on my heart, and I'm going to follow through with that desire, and I'm going to give. And I'm sorry, Caitlin, I'm putting words in your mouth unless you want to come up and tell them on your own. Okay, I'll keep putting words in your mouth then. You know, she's saying, God, you place this on my heart to give, and I'm going to do it, and I'm going to follow through with it. The devil, the enemy, Satan, whatever you want to call him, he does not care about your big dreams. Dream as big as you want to. He don't care about your visions. Be as imaginative as your imagination will take you. But he does care about your follow through. See, you can dream and dream big and never follow through. And as long as you dream and dream big, it's all in your mind. It may even just be on a piece of paper. But once you follow through with that, is when the impact comes. Once you follow through with that, is when lives are changed. Once you follow through with that, is when God is glorified. And so as we look at the close of 2 Corinthians chapter 9, we're going to start at verse 10, and I'm going to read verse 10 and go on down through verse 14. And again, I'm reading in the Good News translation. It says, and God, who supplies seed for the sower and bread to eat, will also supply you with all the seed you need and will make it grow and produce a rich harvest from your generosity. He will always make you rich enough to be generous at all times. Think about that. He will always make you rich enough to be generous at all times. Sometimes we think of being rich enough as having lots of money in the bank. But how many of you know sometimes being rich enough just means having a piece of bread to share with somebody else? He will always make you rich enough to be generous at all times, so that many will thank God for your gifts, which they receive from us. For this service you perform not only meets the needs of God's people, but also produces an outpouring of gratitude to God. And because of the proof which this service of yours brings, many will give glory to God for your loyalty to the gospel of Christ, which you profess, and for your generosity in sharing with them in everything else. And so with deep affection, they will pray for you because of the extraordinary grace God has shown you. Let us thank God for his priceless gift. And so Paul opens up 2 Corinthians chapter 8 with that grace. And he closes 2 Corinthians chapter 9 with grace. And we're seeing that grace is a bookend on giving. And so our giving opens with grace. Then we desire to give. We think about what we can give. We pray over what we can give. Then we actually follow through on that giving. And that closes it with grace so that God is glorified. Amen? Amen? Amen. Let's bow our heads in a word of prayer, please. Most gracious and heavenly Father, Lord God, I've given your people what you have given me. Father, I ask that you would allow us to search your word and understand the truth of your word, O God. And Father, that we would not just hear it and understand it, but that we would also put it into practice and that we would bring it to completion. We give you glory. We give you honor. Father, we lift up those among us that are suffering right now, that are struggling right now, that are facing challenges right now. And we ask that you would use that situation that they're going through to your glory, God. And that we would not be a church that just sits on the hill, but that we would be a church that sits on the hill that makes an impact in our community. We bless you and honor you. In Jesus' name, amen. And so I ask you guys right now, if there are any among us, we're family here, but if there's anyone among us that are not sure of your relationship, not sure of your salvation, we open the doors of the church to you. If there are any that needs a special prayer and that they need the ministers of the church to lay hands on them, then we give you the opportunity to come. Last Friday, on December 1st, we had our night of worship, and we praise and thank God for that night of worship because it was good. It was good. Amen. And so at this time, we ask that the ministers that are serving communion on this morning, if you would come.
We come to you as humbly as we know, thanking you for this blessed day. We thank you for that beautiful message, Heavenly Father. We thank you for the deliverer, Heavenly Father. We pray that you bless Traci, that you continue to strengthen her, dear Lord, that she may continue to preach your word, Heavenly Father. Then allow us to continue to receive your word, Heavenly Father, not just for ourselves, but we may be able to share it with others. Heavenly Father, bless this communion. We thank you for the opportunity, Heavenly Father, realize, dear Lord, that we come doing this as often as we may in remembrance of you, Lord. Forgive us of our sins and all our wrongdoings, Heavenly Father. Lead us and guide us, dear Lord, that we may go in the way that you would have for us to go. It's in Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I give you my soul. moment I'm away. Lord, have your way in me. This is my desire to honor you, Lord, with all my heart, I worship you. Every moment I'm away, Lord, have your way in me.
In 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter, Paul says, "For I received from the Lord the teaching that I passed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took a piece of bread, gave thanks to God, broke it, and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" And so I ask at this time if you would take the bread and eat it. In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup and said, "This cup is God's new covenant, sealed with my blood. Whenever you drink it, do so in remembrance of me." This means that every time you eat this bread and drink from this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Please drink. Father, we thank you and we honor you for your Son and for the sacrifice that he placed, that he made on Calvary's cross. Lord God, as we walk throughout this week, help us to walk in grace, God, the grace that you've freely given us. Help us to remember that because you've given us grace, we need to give grace to others, God. And so may we not keep grace to ourselves, but may we pass it as we go throughout. We honor you, we bless you, and we love you, God. We give you our all, for you truly are our source and our strength. In your Son's name, amen.
Amen.
So I want to remind you guys of a couple of prayer requests as we get ready to close out. Continue to pray for Precious. Continue to pray for Justin and his family. We're asking prayer for Mama Mary. She's not feeling her best right now. And as you guys remember, for those of you that knew Celeste, this is about the time that she transitioned and she made her homecoming. And so while a lot of us are celebrating the holidays with memories of good food and just enjoying each other, there are others that are remembering this time not so fondly. And we ask that you would continue to keep Mama Diane, Mama Leah Simpkins, Mama Norma Nolly, and Pat Ross in your prayers. Are there any other prayer requests before we close? Jackie. Oh, yeah, Jackie. My husband's, I love him, but if anybody knows of a good brand of duct tape or handcuffs, please let me know. I will gladly put them to work about this time.
Sister Tracy.
Yes.
Lavinia Johnson.
Lavinia Johnson?
Yes.
Okay. If you have pen and paper, please put those names down. I'm going to charge you with praying for them over these next 2 weeks as we enter into this time of fasting and prayer, believing that God can do all things but fail. Amen. Are you going to do announcements? Mm-hmm. Okay. We ask Sister Viola to come up and give us our announcements. And then after Viola does the announcements, we'll turn it back into the hands of Pastor to close us out.